This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Schaefer. Hello, Jennifer.
Hello, Richard.
How are you?
I am doing fabulous.
Well, you look fabulous, and I love this new backdrop. Is this permanent or temporary?
It's temporary. I am in San Diego.
Wow.
Yes, I'm here for a retreat with Dr. Joe Dispenza. I went to his movie premiere last night, which was fantastic. You're going to love it because he's been able to measure meditation and what it's done and what it's doing and what it's continuing to doing with science.
That's
which is
great.
Amazing. And so there's going to be a new film out on Netflix.
Wow. What's it called?
It's called Source.
Source. It's within you. Oh, look at you. You have an all access pass. And Luana didn't give it to you, I want to say, because, you know, she is our backstage. Look at that. There you go. Unlimited. Very good. We love that, Jennifer. You do have an access. I just got a note from the copyright office, the latest book. They're saying, you know, you have interviews in your book, and have you gotten permission from the people you're interviewing on paper? You know, and it's like, okay, that's my 13th book. You know, people off stage, they can't really grant permission. I mean, they can, but, you know, then they got to come to our podcast.
I think by talking to us, they have, but.
I think so too, but, you know, whatever.
And they would, because I've talked to their families. So there's a lot of permissions that I could actually say yes to.
No, that's true. And there was only one person in the latest book, Close Encounters of the Flipside Kind, which I talked about on.
I'm so excited.
It was so
George Norrie, right? Weren't you on George Norrie?
That's right. Talking to George Norrie. And it was so much fun. I got to say, you know, sometimes it's late at night. We start at 10 and go to midnight, and I'm, you know, flagging. But in this case, it was fun. He had a lot of fun stuff. And I'll tell you, it was interesting. And like what happens with us sometimes, we were talking about telepathy and how there are people out there on the planet whose lives have been saved by a voice, you know, that says, put on your seatbelt, you know, don't get on that plane. And in the case of Gary Schwartz, the PhD, that happened to him when he was out of Harvard. And a voice told him to put his wife's seatbelt on and his. And a few seconds later, they were rear-ended and thrown out of the car. And the doctor said, you would not have survived. A guy named Bill Bennett, filmmaker, driving to the airport in New Orleans, green light, and he speeds up and hears a voice say, no, stop the car. And if at first he ignores it, the car, he stops the car. And a truck, you know, runs a red light, would have been screened. And so...
Yeah, go ahead.
George Norrie says that happened to me. And then he recounts this, you know, story that's identical. He's driving in St. Louis and he's in traffic and he's going a good clip. And some voice says to him, pull over. And he like goes, no, you know, like in his mind, like, why would I pull over? And it shouts it again, pull over. He does and nearly gets clipped by, you know, somebody going the other, you know, running a red light. So it happens.
It happened. There's so many countless stories like that. I love that. I use it for everyday stuff. Like, should I do a podcast? Is today going to be okay to do a podcast? I get told yes. Should I go downstairs and go to registration right now? Or is there lots of lines? No, go in 15 minutes. I went in 15 minutes. There was no line.
Oh, wow.
And I mean, I listen to it every single day. Should I work on a case? So there was a case that came in of a missing person. Should I do that today? I mean, I'm cramming so much in today. I was told yes, but I just listened to it because it's never been wrong. I've learned now if I go against it, I don't ask questions if I don't want to know the answer. Like, should I work out today? If I don't, you know, want to know the answer, don't ask it. But I just, it's such a better way to live too.
Well, I think it's fascinating because once I met you and once you demonstrated to me these really obvious things about, you know, yes, no, left, right, up, down, I had this idea like, what kind of ice cream should I have? And then I think I'll call Jennifer, you know, and that becomes this thing. But it is really about gut instinct. It's the instinct of, you know, something. Now, this thing just popped into my head and I want to mention it, which is, you know, we have that forum on Quora, Hacking the Afterlife.
Right. So this, by the way, how many views?
The 50 million over the past 5 years.
Bravo.
Well, I don't
know. That's a lot of views for your work.
It is a lot of work for our work too. But here's the point.
I remember when you first started, I'm like, what is that? How do you spell Quora?
Quora, yeah. And answering questions. And I mean, who are you to answer questions? But, you know, I try to cite the data, cite the research, and I'll make a space for people to have experiences that they've had with the flip side. So this happened, you know, the books about Close Encounters of the Flip Side, kind of people who recall seeing, you know, other beings from other planets, you know, and of course they've been taught to say, oh, that's creepy and weird. And I don't, you know, it freaks me out. But this one woman, Gail Rivers, I hope she doesn't mind me saying her name, but she is in Wisconsin and she wrote that she's in her 70s, but when she was 5 or 6 years old, she was on a farm and her family, I just realized we could talk to this guy. She was on a farm and she saw a little person, like a foot tall, a little being, like five, a foot tall, come out of the corn. And, you know, 5 or 6 years old, and then looked at this person, and then the person saw them looking at, you know, they looked at each other, what? And then disappeared, you know, ran back into the corn. So I pointed out, as we've been doing, you can take any event that happened, including something like that, dramatic, it's outside of time. And by just doing this guided meditation of just freezing the frame and asking questions and not judging the answer. So she wrote me back this morning and with like a whole series of questions that she asked. It was fascinating because the creature, the person, the being said, you know, we like to come here, that being small allows us to see things from a different perspective, that there's so much negativity that happens here. It's almost like a war zone. It's like coming to a wartime game, you know, where people are fighting back and forth. She asked why this particular place, and he said it's peaceful here in this farm. He said it's like there's a bubble that protects, you know, everybody that's in this arena. And then he went on to say, you know, humans really, and this was back in the 50s, this happened to her, but the message was, you humans really need to work on nature and fixing nature and helping each other, and, you know,
that was back then,
you know. And so here we are. But here's the point. She did what I suggested, which was just examine it and see if you can hear new information that might come from somebody like that. And I really have to applaud her for doing that, because of course people in the, you know, the core forum were like, you're nuts. That's nutty. Like, you know, come on. You know, anyway.
But that's you don't believe it. Everybody's belief is right to their own accord. Like, whatever you believe in is right. We're not here to make anyone believe in anything. We're here to give through our research and through our experiences, give what we know, but that doesn't mean you have to believe it. Figure it out on your own.
Absolutely. Or that learning that you may have been here before, or that you may incarnate elsewhere, doesn't change the fact that you're here now. You're enjoying pizza and cappuccinos and loving and living and loving and meeting new people and having a blast, drinking my coffee. So, you know, it's not that we're saying people have to. I was talking about this with somebody today. I said, you know, it's not like you have to go depth in deep with this kind of information. People do sign up for lifetimes where they don't learn anything. And that's okay too. There's nothing wrong with, you know, being a boxer and my whole life is the ring. And then at the end of that life, then they get off stage and they're like, wow, all I did was fight. That was wild. What a weird, you know, and their friends are like, good job. You did a great job. You know, we know you planned it, but whatever.
Giving me the chills, darn it. Yeah, with whatever you're talking about.
Well, let's talk to Luana, because she is the chill maker. Our friend Luana Anders on the flip side, who is a moderator of our podcast over there. Is there somebody she wants us to talk to or meet with or hang out with?
It's actually Kobe Bryant. That's interesting.
Let's not judge it. I'm sorry, my lips don't seem to be working today.
I have talked to him before.
Have
and I
time.
have talked to
Go ahead, please go ahead. You've spoke to him.
I don't call it like it's interesting because he's popped in a couple times recently, but I haven't said anything. I'm like, hi, I haven't talked to him, but for whatever reason, through things that, oh, my meditation this morning, he just showed me.
Well,
he actually made fun
Okay. Yes, he made fun of you. Go ahead. I was going to say, last week he did show up briefly. You mentioned his first name, but we didn't ask him questions. And he has shown up a long time ago. The first time he showed up, I spoke to him in Italian because he speaks Italian, and he answered in English. So that was
it. Wait. Hold on. Let me. He just came by to say thank you for something that I did for his family.
Kobe, do you have a few words for the people in the audience tuning in who miss you terribly? And if there's anything you want to add.
Come on. He's like, keep your eye on the ball, which is funny.
What does that mean? What do you mean by that?
Well, he just showed me a bunch of things like in a nutshell. And he wants me to explain the process of just what happened. That's interesting. So he just showed me like basketball and him, like his passion about how he took it further, like working out. Like it was very sweet. He used to work out with his daughter, like very, very sweet. Like all the stuff that he did to make himself a better player. And then he showed me really fast that I'm here for this meditation retreat because I want to be a better player with my own work. And I know last year, and you've been telling me this for how many years since you met me, meditate. And it finally hit me after this long that it finally hit me that I could do this for myself, which is also very challenging because when I go quiet, dead people talk to me. So I have to, like, when I want to do it for myself, it takes a little bit more effort. I feel that I'm not comparing myself to anybody else, but for myself, it takes a little bit more effort for me to really do it just for myself and not necessarily, because the first thing I want to do is go talk to my parents. When I have a quiet moment, I want to go see what they're doing or say hello to them. Or, you know, I'm trying not to, when they show up, freak out and think something's wrong with a family member, like I always do, or I used to do. So he was just showing me the process, which for people, you know, it comes in, of course, when you get it, he's trying to say, you know, about the information when the class wants to explain, the whole class, not just him, that when people get information, it comes through in so many different ways. And the way that mine is visual, he shows me lots of pictures and feelings. He makes me feel things, but it's different for everybody in the way that they do this work or in the way that they get information, because everybody has different ways of perceiving information, as you know, and its interpretation. So hold on. Interesting. Your eye on the ball is going to be a different perception each time. It's going to come in a different way. It's going to come in a different feeling, different emotion. Everyone's different with what they're focusing on.
So like keep the eye on your ball, on your journey.
Stay in your lane and stop comparing yourself to
stay
others.
Stay in your lane. But I mean, here's a guy who really worked and worked and worked and worked, and he was the master of his craft. But he's also saying, correct me if I'm wrong, he's saying that we can master the crafts that we're involved in by keeping a focus on the ball, which might include whatever. It could be learning how to meditate. By the way, med means measure in Latin, and it's just measuring your thoughts.
What does medlin mean? That's my
main. Oh, my God, yeah, you're the measure, of course, medlin. It would be the city of meds. But the idea of measuring reality, you can rewire your brain, you can rewire your habits, you can get rid of phobias by rewiring the brain, by using meditation as a tool. Is that correct? Okay. And so he's saying he's applauding you for doing that.
A lot more than I used to. Yes.
Well, you know, here, what does it feel like for you, Kobe? You know, we had that conversation a couple of years ago, the first initial one, and now here we are chatting again. Does it feel like a while, or does it feel like a short amount of time between now and then?
He first gave me the word surreal. It feels very surreal. Like I'm in both worlds, just like, and then he just showed me going in both worlds too. He's like, it is true. We can help anyone that asks.
So surreal by the idea that you're not only hanging out with your family, let's say, and people that you knew and your loved ones.
Well, so it took me a little, I get asked all the time, is my mom with my dad or, with clients of mine? And they tell me yes, but it was interesting because even I questioned it. I'm like, Mom, are you really with dad? And they both came on the side of me and made me feel them both.
Wow, that's
But it was
beautiful.
the first of what I felt. I'm like, wow, maybe the Mormons have it right. Families can be together forever,
Sealed. They're sealed, but that kind of implies you can't get away from them. But
Yeah. But my
it's
dad
become.
has his other five wives though, too, remember?
Oh yeah, that's right.
Haven't
But
asked about that.
just not to tease my wife as well, her family members are from Utah. But the idea is that we are sealed in a way to those we love.
The light. Yeah, absolutely.
Almost tethered to
Yeah.
like Christmas lights, which is another way of looking at it. I love that he gives you the chills and then you go to put on your faux.
It's always so. I'm highly allergic to everything. In fact, my room has down in it, and I'm like, you've got to be kidding me.
Wow. Yeah, I get that. I don't like that either.
Awful.
Or, so Kobe. What is it you would like to say to your fans and friends that are on the planet, especially in Los Angeles, who miss you terribly, think about you all the time?
Do something great, something that you enjoy, that you're good at. And if you can't find, everybody's good at something. Just figure it out. I'm still here. Like, I'm still here.
Well, and listen, this is a weird question. You probably don't remember meeting me, but I'm wondering if
Well,
that.
I don't know, but let me, were you with Jack Nicholson?
No, but I was with the manager of the Lakers. His wife is an old friend of mine, or was his ex-wife was an old friend of mine, Mitch Kupchak, and he introduced me to Kobe. It was his first year, and it was first trip coming to LA, and it was like I think his first screening. It was a movie screening.
He says he definitely remembers you because they have all the memories. But if he was here, he might not have remembered you.
No, and the reason I ask is not, for me it was thrilling, but my the reason is I my question is more about process. Is the fact that you've seen my frequency, does that make it easier for you to connect with somebody on the planet, or is that not important at all?
Yes, because I know that you wanted to talk to me. So be clear in what you asked, I guess, the universe. Be clear,
Well,
he's
if
showing me, he's
go
showing
ahead.
me how entangled I am with so many people that he knows.
That's right. That's right. But when we first
You
chatted,
don't have to, he goes, you could be a kid in Guatemala that's never met me, but was a huge fan. He goes, it's a different type of entanglement, and I could still help that kid.
so their intent, in a way, is almost like dialing into the frequency that is you. Is that correct? Something along those lines?
Yes.
And so I asked you, cosa ti manchi di Italia? Qualche macchina italiana ti piace meglio? And you put an image in Jennifer's mind. You want to show her that image again?
I don't, he showed me, I felt ice cream, but he showed me a Ferrari.
I asked him what he missed about Italia, Italy. The most is there a machine
Driving
driving
fast.
fast, and a machina is a Ferrari, or a Ferrari is a machina. The point being, Jennifer doesn't speak Italian, and but I can ask him questions in Italian because I know the intent of what I'm asking. Telepathically, I'm thinking of his red Ferrari that he owned, and I know he went to a play in Italy for a while and he learned how to speak Italian. So
Yeah.
those kinds of things, it shows that we can transcend this kind of blocks that we have about talking to people. What's he saying?
Oh, I was just asking him a question. Sorry.
Go ahead. It's all right. It's allowed. I mean, you don't have to share it if you don't want to, but is there something he would like to chat about or talk about?
He answered it.
Okay, he answered the question. Very good.
Sorry, had to do with something that was in a personal reading, and then I asked a little bit further about that. That's all.
I understand. Yeah, no, I understand. So, I mean, it's kind of funny because, of course, he shows up and everybody would love to hear, everyone would love to hear him play, hear him talk and see him play again.
Yeah.
Who are you watching any athletes on the flip side from where you are? Is there anyone that you focus on that you want to single out? I mean, March Madness is happening. Go ahead, you're seeing something.
It's interesting because he's not really watching basketball. He's watching other sports.
Okay, and what other sport comes to mind when I ask that
Like,
question?
don't get me wrong, I love basketball, but I kind of know basketball, so he goes, I'd rather watch race car driving.
Because he loved to drive fast, yeah.
And then he showed me one of my other another friend of mine's husband, Anže Kopitar for the LA Kings. He's like, it's a brutal sport playing
Hockey.
hockey.
Yeah, exactly. They're missing a lot of teeth. All right, very good. Thank you so much for stopping by to talk to us, Kobe. That's just wonderful. So any athlete that you want to single out, not in basketball, but
He says the Kings can make it.
oh, the Kings. Okay, very good. All right, so he's a fan. Luana, is this the conversation you want us to have? Is there anybody else that we should talk to?
Hold on. What about him? There's another person, but we can't talk about him on air, so we'll talk about him afterwards. Just
All right. And so is this
fine.
a person that Luana has brought forward? And
He's still here.
oh, he's still here. Okay. Well, Lou, who is it that we can talk to on the air? Because you know Jennifer's schedule. You work with her quite often.
Hold on.
Who needs to come by and chat with us?
What? When? Okay, this is what they showed me. I'm going to give you imagery. They showed me you playing golf. Then they showed me Roger Dangerfield playing when he put Caddyshack.
Okay.
And then what was the other thing they showed me? Oh, and it feels like a dream that you had. Did you have a dream playing golf or anything like that?
No, but I
Or
did
was
have
there
some
something?
unusual dreams the past couple of days talking to people elsewhere. But let's break it down a little bit. Rodney Dangerfield may re now the Luana's got a sense of humor. Rodney may relate to her friend Hot Lips. Is that's ask her, is that correct? And I'll explain why. Okay, you tapped
Yeah.
your nose. So Rodney, you have
I
no
have
idea.
no.
So, and this is Luana's way of saying, this is how you can access people on the other side. So Sally Kellerman, who was Luana's best friend from like teenage on, and I became friends with Sally and hung out with her all the way up until her passing.
Love
Sally,
the chocolate.
sorry?
She loved the chocolates you
Love
gave
the
her.
chocolate. Randall Kleiser, the film director who made Grease, and I used to go and visit her and bring her favorite drug, chocolate. But Sally starred with Rodney Dangerfield in a film.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Does Rodney want to come through or does Sally want to come through?
Sally wants to come through, and I did see Alan Alda, so yeah, that's interesting. And I know he's still alive.
Yeah. But I'm in what's funny about Rodney is that I played his hands in a movie. Somebody invited me to come down and play the piano.
Okay, so you played. Oh, that's
I had
interesting.
to dress up like Rodney Dangerfield. He was in his underwear playing the piano, and they wanted my hands to be playing.
That's why they had to show me. Okay, they're just talking about imagery and why we broke it down. So I saw you playing golf, and then they switched it real fast because it looked like, it was with Roger Dangerfield, Roger, whatever his name is. And then I think they were trying to get to the part that you played him because you look like you were wearing the same goofy outfits that he would wear
I was wearing
playing
the
golf.
same goofy outfit. That's what I was playing, Rodney's hands. Anyway, and
That's
in this goofy
amazing.
movie, I can't even remember the name of the film. But I met him on the set, and I just remember while I was doing the scene, the director was looking through the eyepiece and he said, "Wait a minute, is that Rich Martini?" Because the music supervisor had brought me in. And he was like, Richard, I've seen your movies. And I went, yeah, yeah, listen, this is my day gig. I'm playing the piano, playing Rodney's hands. But Sally Kellerman, I'm sorry, Sally, what's going on? What's up? Happy Good Friday. What do you want to talk about?
She says, I want to talk about how fun it is up here.
Please tell us, what does that mean?
Huh. A lot of people are afraid of, dying or death. They have this fear, this imminent fear of like dying. And I think we might've discussed this, but it doesn't, you know, and I think you might've said it, which made perfect sense. How we, even though we stop breathing here, we end up breathing over there. Like, it's just a brief moment where we don't
breathe.
Not like something. Yeah. We still have a different way of breathing over there. We get to have fun dancing and playing ourselves in movies. I guess that's what they were saying. I think there's some type of anniversary date that's coming up. And I don't know, her husband, is he's over on the other side, correct?
That's right, Jonathan. And we've talked to Jonathan briefly.
I don't know if it would have been 70. How long were they married for?
Long time. And Jonathan was a film producer who produced Travolta's movies, a lot of them, and three movies for me. So,
oh, I didn't know that. Wow. Okay.
Yeah, Look Who's Talking, his film, and some other ones. But Jonathan, do you want to say hello? What does Jonathan want to say?
Took a long time to try to get me out here. To get me up here, we had to go from Roger Dangerfield to Sally Kellerman. Yeah,
well, you're in line, buddy. And Sally did get nominated for an Oscar, so there you go. What's up, Jonathan? Listen, I miss you because you were the only human that would like hire me to direct a movie. So tell us, what's going on?
Oh. Don't give up hope on the Amelia movie.
Oh, thank you. Very good. I'm working with somebody right now on that project. So knock on wood, we'll find a way to put her. Yeah, yeah, I am. Yeah, George Nuri asked me, what's your next project? I said, you know.
I didn't listen to that, but okay.
No, you didn't. But, you know, it's interesting because he asked me about it. He asked me about this, you know, aircraft that somebody found at the bottom of the ocean. And I pointed out all the research I've been doing for the past 30 years. People, you know, who saw her and took care of her and found her plane and found her briefcase and found her passport and all that other stuff. But we've decided to tell her story from her point of view. So you've been immensely helpful in that and bringing her to life for us. You have been. And, you know, that's in the book, Hacking the Afterlife. There's a whole interview that Jennifer does with Amelia. It's mind bending, but it's continued on because now I'm trying to sort of do that in my mind's eye with all the people in her life. Like, what was it like for them? What was the real story? What really happened outside the news reels? And that's what makes it kind of fascinating, because then we can talk about humanity in a way and let her tell her real story of what really happened to her. So
everybody's rooting for you on this one.
Okay. We love that. I appreciate that.
I know. You're like, how does that translate?
But Sally, you know, I think that's an interesting point for you to make. Sally was somebody who loved life, who used to have like parties, you know, like at her house, even when she was not successful. And then when she was successful, all of Hollywood would be there, you know, musicians. And I met Frank Gehry there. I met all kinds of people that were in Sally's orbit, and they loved her. And they loved, you know, she had people get up and perform and sing. Marilyn Bergman sang, and all these other people.
That's so
and
cool.
That was Sally. She had that kind of, you know, so apparently.
She also like like an animal rights activist or something.
Well, she was an animal lover. Yeah, very deeply so.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask Sally.
That's why she said that. So she said that it's something that, you know, also the animals come to you when you cross over on the other side, and everyone really needs to know how much they come to you and how the kindness that you give any animal or tree or plant, she's showing me how that also shows up when you leave the planet. And she's just like, she goes, it would have taken me 100 days to get through all just the animals and trees and plants and everything, you know, Earth days, I guess you could say. Just with all the love of the, you know, the circulation of love. So the energy that you match, and it's not about your health, but the energy that your spirit holds from the time you were little gets to go. Like they said, okay, thank you. When you leave, you get to have all the love at once of everything that's ever loved you and everybody that you've ever loved all at once. Not, they don't, you know, they always, I always ask like what happened the last day, but just to validate who they are so I can tell people, you know, tell the people in front of me.
Sure.
But it was very, very interesting. That's very sweet. Sorry.
I knew some of her pets, and it was actually in a movie that we did together, You Can't Hurry Love. At some point I had her pretend to be the head of this advertising agency, and she's talking to this employee and she goes, what about Pinky and Chico? And the guy is a liar, and he's like, oh yeah, I love them, they're the best employees I've ever worked with. And she looks at him and says, Pinky and Chico are my dogs, which was true. So I know who Pinky and Chico are, and I know that they greeted Sally on the flip side. I mean, it's just, it's a wonderful thing to say. And it's also verification, because you and I have done this for so long. We know the animals they're talking about. And now Sally's just saying, as a general thing, if you ever had a pet or an animal, they greet you or are available to you or accessible to you, because they too have a higher portion of their consciousness back home always. Even if they're incarnated, even if they've come back as a parakeet, that higher conscious energy is there to greet you, to give you that love back that you gave to them. I mean, it's a wonderful thing to hear. And it does make people crazy, because then when you start thinking about it, they're like, well, why do we treat animals so badly on Earth? What's the matter with us? And it is a good
Like, I miss Chloe so much, you know, just even thinking about that. I was just being shown Chloe and I'm like, did I still do the right thing? You know, did we do the right thing? You know, Chloe, but she's like,
question. Come on, what does Chloe say?
Chloe just says, you made me wait too long to leave.
To leave, you know, and so putting somebody down. I mean, it's just a weird question that we have. And, you know, I think it's important to state it. Sally just said it. There's a lot of love and a lot of joy on the flip side, but that doesn't mean you should leave the stage. That doesn't mean you should get off the stage early. That doesn't mean you should quit the play just because there's a lot of fun on the flip side. We're here for a reason, and we're here to experience stuff, but we can help heal others while we're on stage. And so therefore, we can't even realize that we might be still on stage lingering to help somebody else. It could be a nurse.
That's exactly what Chloe showed me, my husband, Freddie, who had the hardest time letting her go. And she said, you know, she's just like, I had to wait for him to be okay.
That's beautiful. You know? Beautifully said. And, you know, and people I know and they feel more connected to the animals than they do anybody else on stage. And I hear it all the time on our forum on Quora, where people are saying, you know, I lost my, you know, animal. And I try to give them context and perspective. You know, animals might live 20 years and, you know, we might live 80. And so they might come back. They may go off stage and say, you know, I'm coming back. I'm going to keep haunting you, you know, from the earth, and show up again. Yeah. And the odd thing is they talk about finding us, how we think we drove over to the, you know, pet store or the animal shelter, and, you know, we thought that this was all our thing that we were doing, and then they show us, oh no, you know, I was the one who put the idea in your head. Get in the car, go over to the shop. You know, I'm waiting for you. It's very powerful. Sally, anything else you want to mention, my dear?
Love again. Love the word love. Give yourself love. You know, that's part of, you know, when you do meditation, you can funnel that, you can connecting your heart and your brain, and that coherence of love helps. It just does something, you know. And
so did you know Robin Williams when you were on the planet, or do you know him over there?
Better now, she says.
And tell us something about Robin. Is he still as
he's hilarious? Still interesting. He's studying for another act, she says.
Please tell us a little bit about that, if you don't mind. What does that mean?
He wants to become a normal person without fame on Earth.
Oh, for the next time around. Well, Sally, do you want to invite Rob?
She's showing me, he's like holding the Bible, like something like a
biblical salesman, a Bible salesman. We know about one of those. Well, let's ask Robin to come through. Robin, if you don't mind, I know you're busy planning your next stage appearance. What is it you want to tell people on the planet, please?
That if everyone does it together, feeling more love has got to pollinate the planet. He showed me like bees, like having, you know, the pollination. He just showed me like the love just spreading everywhere, that where it's like almost like that invisible, you know how they do it when on TV with somebody leaves and it's like a, you know, like a bunch of stardust or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, like Star Trek, and the energy blows out.
Right. And he says that, so he's making me feel those visuals. And then he's saying that, or a unicorn fart. That's actually pretty funny. Stop it.
It's allowed. He can be funny.
No, he can't. I'll explain why. We're supposed to dress up as our future selves, and I'm going as a unicorn tonight.
Okay, unicorn farts will be following you behind. Don't forget.
No, that's not happening. But that was funny that he said that, because he did reference me. Okay.
But that stardust of love, that dust of love, you can spread it everywhere.
It's contagious. He just showed me sneezing. It's contagious and people love it. And whether they, you know,
when I sneeze from now on, I'm going to say bless Robin instead of bless you, bless Robin, because the sneeze will remind me that the love of the germs is going out of the universe, just like Robin Williams has gone out into the universe to spread love. Achoo, bless Robin.
Bless Robin.
You like that, Robin? Was that a good idea? Will it catch on?
He thinks it has some legs to it, but yeah.
I'm sorry, say that again?
It has some legs to it.
Some legs. It needs a little bit more of a help along the way. Bless Robin. Achoo. Anyway, I was sitting in a theater when I heard somebody behind me say, Mrs. Doubtfire died. And I'm thinking to myself, what does that mean? And then I realized, I was in a premiere of The Giver, and Jeff Bridges was on stage, and then he got up and announced to the world from the stage and burst into tears and told wonderful, beautiful stories about Robin, as we've all heard them. And I did have a dream about him. I think I mentioned it not too long ago, where I was riding through the tunnel that's in Marin. He used to ride bikes, and they named the tunnel after him. It's the Robin Williams Tunnel. And I was riding on a bike with him, and I could see the Golden Gate coming, in the distance, like through a light. And he said, looked over his shoulder and said, "You see, I am the light at the end of the tunnel." Beautifully said, Robin. Love.
He's like, we all are, though. He's just showing a bunch of people being the light at the end of the tunnel. He's like, what if there's no beginning or end of the tunnel?
No, that's right. It's just another version of, coming out of any tunnel into the next realm. Anything else, Robin, you might want to?
Coming out of your mind and into your heart.
Getting out of your mind and into your heart, out of your head space and into your heart space. We heard that from Steve Jobs. It's in the book Close Encounters. Am I losing you? Is that what's happening?
Yeah.
I have to go into the other world and talk to normal people.
Something like that.
Okay, like, Jennifer.
I asked my guy, it's like, can you do heightened security, please, up there for me?
Heightened security for Jennifer. In other words, keep out the people that are, stressed. I've had the experience in a dream where somebody shows up and it's like stressful. And I just say, look, I'm sorry, I can't help you. Go talk to Jennifer.
They're actually doing a pretty good job, because every time I've gone in, because I was really worried about going to the movie, which is fine. I'm
You mean the Joe Dispenza movie?
Yeah, just not worried, but I always get a little bit, my heart rate goes up a lot. But for some reason, I felt just this calmness, which was awesome. And then going down to registration, when I listened to him and there was nobody in line, I'm like, thank you guys. Like, you know, and I saw, you know, people that I saw last time, but I was just so grateful because they do calm my heart down. I just need to know that they're doing that and not think about it.
Well, you know, and we've heard this before that our loved ones on the flip side, they're the ones who talk us into going into the theater because they want to see the latest movie. And they have the experience of, while we're watching it, of like sitting around us. I guess they don't really have popcorn for people on the flip side, but still they get to appreciate and enjoy the film that they're seeing along with everybody in the audience. So it's a really complicated, you know, ticket that will be in the future. You'll have to pay for you and your relative. Like the old days when you used to get into the drive-in and all your friends would climb in the trunk.
No.
Oh, you don't remember that? And then you'd pull up and you'd hear this knock knock. Let me out. Nah, we'll let you out when the popcorn gets here. Anyways, all right, Jennifer, I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for doing this. And I know we have a lot of fans out there who thank you for doing this too and appreciate you. Our conversations with the flip side.
I firmly believe that, you know, in the future, people are going to know that this is all accessible. Like, and the more that we're able to make it accessible and the more that people are actually paying attention and getting their, you know, actually believing in the signs that they get or, you know, believing in things that are happening. Like, I think that could be, you know, somebody's new normal, which will make them feel more connected. You know, the biggest heartache is not being connected. And when you know you're connected, you feel just so much better. It just helps your heart, right?
It's so true. And thank you for helping people connect to their loved ones on the other side. I did get an email from somebody whose husband had passed away, and she had sent me those videos of like the ring door where you saw lights going by. And then I told her to reach out to you, and then she wrote me this really beautiful letter, Michelle, saying, thank you so much, because I now am convinced and believe my husband is keeping an eye on me and his family. And you really made that happen for us to realize they're not gone. They're just not here. It's a beautiful gift. Thank you so much. Thanks, Luana. Thanks, Kobe. Thanks, Robin. And thanks, Hot Lip.
Happy Easter, everyone.
Happy Easter. And you know what? I want to just say this. Today wasn't such a good Friday for one of our friends, but otherwise it's Happy Good Friday as well. You know, people talk about it being Good Friday, and I think, well, ask Jesus what he thought about Friday. Not such a good day. That was really not a good day for him. But anyway.
Oh my gosh.
We can all have a conversation. And we can read the one plug here, which is, you know, we could read that book, The Greatest Story Ever Told, for Easter.
Never told. Amazing. It's
He's
amazing.
To anybody who wants to talk to him. All right. Thank you very much, Jennifer. We love you.
Okay, bye. Bye.
This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Schaefer. For more information, jennifershaefer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on Amazon Prime.